This is Three Dog.
How can I help?
Sophistry, a show where we dive into the world of video games and tech, telling you how to spend your money.
Isn't that nice of us?
Here are your gaming hosts, Andy Borkowski and Shaggy Dave.
The show's about to begin.
VGS.
Shall we play a game?
Begins now.
VGS is performed in front of a live studio audience.
This is VGS. I'm your host, Andy Borkowski, and I'm wishing you to come on down. We have here to my left a contestant you're very familiar with. He's here on the show every week, never won a damn thing, Davis Bargala.
Hi.
We also have three other fresh new faces, faces we've never seen before. The man to my right, who I'll be paying in guild today, Nason.
Hello.
That's Nason. We also have right beside him...
How's it going? My name's Matt.
That's Matt the Intern. Everyone loves Matt the Intern. And, of course, a reigning champ. He's been on the show many times. Marketing director of the Anime Club at Humber College, Thomas!
Hey there. I'm Thomas.
Congratulations, everyone. You've all won the chance to listen to VGS this week, the most exciting video game show in the world!
Hi, everyone. This is, of course, VGS. We decided to enter the show a little bit differently. We hope you enjoy it. If you heard that and you're very upset, please, of course, send your emails vgs@640toronto.com. I am very excited. We're going to have a fun show. The whole team is here. Dave, that was great.
Exciting stuff.
It is exciting stuff. for this week's show, we're going to change things up a little bit. You're going to hear more of our voices. Like I said before, you might not hear it, but my voice is a little bit charred.
You're getting better, man. You're healing.
I am healing. I'm a survivor.
You actually listened to the show.
I did.
Oh,
I did.
It's only 3 weeks late?
Yeah, they did a show 1 week when I wasn't here, and I was very upset about it. But you guys got it done.
We did. It was the best show we've ever done.
I don't know about that. Of course, this week, what we'll be talking about is a lot of gaming news. You know, we will have a chance to discuss it. We have a lot of different minds here, the interns that I introduced beforehand, that come from different sides of the angles. You know, they care about different parts of the video game world. So we're going to discuss the game Overwatch that people are very, very excited about and some of the controversy there. And we'll inadvertently talk about Quantum Break, even though we kind of don't want to.
Yeah. But we're bright, so the game's bright, and we have to talk about it.
There you go. It wasn't exactly our thing, but there's something interesting that Remedy Games is doing that we wanted to touch base on. Of course, the big interview, our feature interview this week, is something that is kind of special. There's a game that came out this week, 1979 Revolution Black Friday. It is about the Iranian Civil War. And we got to speak with a man who made it, Navid Khonsari, who's actually from that era, whose family left, and it's a really, really interesting interview, a game you got to play. That's what I've been playing this week. I've been spending tons of time on it. David Spargala, what about you?
I have been playing a little bit more of NHL 16. I still got my
every Simpsons. Week.
Yeah,
every
yeah.
Week.
I mean, I got to put some time into this. I don't, yeah. I mean, I'm working all the time, so it's yeah. tough.
What mode do you play in NHL? Like, are you, because my...
All-Star.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, All-Star, yeah, yeah.
Do you have yourself? Is it like you?
No, I don't care. I think I'm not in grade six. I mean,
okay, I guess
with the times.
I guess I'll delete my character then.
Yeah, okay. And I got my Simpsons Tapped Out going. We got the new update with the fireman, the Apu fireman.
The Apu fireman.
Apu Nahasapita Padawan fireman outfit.
Okay.
And Principal Skinner playing a little bit of Quantum Break and the Miitomo one.
Oh, yeah.
I made Brock. I think I mentioned it last week.
You did. Yeah, yeah, you're playing that stupid game. Nason, one of the interns who is here as well, what have you been doing with your thumbs this last week?
Oh, so many things. But when it comes to video games, what I've been doing is playing Just Cause 3.
Big That's fan an old of, one. You're jumping into that.
Well,
now.
Yeah, yeah. I'm a big fan of the Just Cause games. I think they're just fun and over the top. And like, there's nowhere else you can grapple onto a helicopter and throw a grenade on it that turns into its own personal little jet that throws the helicopter up further and then it explodes.
Yeah. Glad that you're finally
awesome.
Jumping
a lot
into
of fun.
It.
Yeah, thanks.
Matt, the intern.
When I was a kid, I used to play the Elder Scrolls game, and I found the CD that I bought when I was a kid, Oblivion.
What?
And I actually recently just modded the crap out of it, so it looks absolutely beautiful.
That is quite a game. Did you guys, just to the panel, did you guys ever jump into that? Is that ever your thing, Dave?
No.
I did. I had Oblivion, yeah, me too. I had
yeah,
Oblivion
yeah,
when I was growing up.
Yeah.
I was a big Morrowind fan.
Yeah? Oh, yeah. Of course you would. Marketing director of the anime club. That game for me, Oblivion, I remember that was the first game that I checked the time played, and it was 300 hours.
Oh, yeah.
Easily. And I remember, I think I played it twice, and I hit that benchmark both times. So clearly, I was a very popular person in high school.
Yeah, and I had a lot of hours as well, because the DLC, like the Shivering Isles and et cetera, and the Knights of the Nine, absolutely great story-driven, and I, like, because usually DLCs crumble apart, but yeah, they played it well.
What a great answer, Matt the Intern. I would hate to follow that. Tom, what about you?
I played a little bit of Civ 5. I'm a big fan of Civ 5, probably my most played game ever, because it just takes so long that it adds up after time. I try to get in one game a week, normally, if I can.
Of Civilization.
Of Civ 5, yeah.
Yeah.
I've also been playing Vampires the Masquerade Bloodlines, which is 2002, I think.
It is, yeah.
It's been on my backlog for a long time. I play the tabletop version of it with my group every week, so I decided I'd dive into the video game and see how that was.
Well, how did you enjoy it? Because I've been advocating for this game.
Yeah, I just finished it just the other day. I loved it. It's probably in my top 10 now.
The choice that you have in that game, based on the initial choices you make of like what kind of vampire you are.
Yeah.
Extend for the entire, and it's so much fun.
Exactly.
The combat worked. It really like kind of before its time in a lot of ways.
A little bit, yeah.
An absolutely insane game. Make sure you pick it up. Vampire the Masquerade.
Make sure you pick up this 14-year-old game.
You should. It's a lot of fun. Well, we got amazing. So this is what the team is playing. We are the video game experts, and half of us are playing games that are over 10 years old this week.
Old games are like wine.
Bad for you in mass quantities.
Yeah.
Coming up next, we will have our news of the week, what's new, Pussycats, all of your favorite gaming treats here on VGS.
This is VGS with Andy and Dave on Talk Radio, AM 640.
Andy back here, rubbing his ears because the sound was very loud coming in.
It's not my fault. It's the op.
Definitely the op's fault.
Yeah, blame her.
This is David Spargala always here. It was you. Don't blame the op.
The op's fault. It's always the op's fault. It's never the host's fault.
Here on VGS, we are, of course, talking about all the latest and greatest in gaming news. If you missed the first segment, congratulations, because we tried something new. It definitely landed.
Yeah, you missed a lot.
Yeah, you missed a lot. But we have a whole...
If you miss it, just download the podcast version.
Where do you get that again?
640toronto.com/VGS. I think it's a forward slash, isn't it?
Yes.
It's a slash.
It's a slash.
It's not the guitarist. All of our shows are there.
Yeah, no, there's tons of articles as well. A lot of the interns here also write content for that. We relegate them to transcribe a lot of our interviews, and they love it. So really happy to have them here. But on this week's show, we're going to be talking about some news stories that have broken out in the video game world. And then it's that big interview I alluded to in the first segment, 1979 Revolution Black Friday, a game based on the Iranian Civil War. Very heavy stuff. But we're not going to jump into that just yet because it can be very depressing.
Yep. I. What else am I going to say? Yep.
Well, you could say no. You could fight me on it.
No, it is very depressing.
It is. But what's equally as depressing is that it's taken this long for us to introduce one of my favorite segments.
What's new, Pussycat? Whoa, whoa, whoa. What's new, Pussycat? Whoa, 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 whoa.
Tom.
He's alive.
He is alive. Last week, we thought he was dead. This is the segment where, of course, we reintroduce you to all of the games that will be coming out in the next 7 days, Sunday to Sunday, starting with, we all agree, probably the biggest release, Dark Souls 3 from From Software, available on Xbox One, PS4, and the PC on April 12th, a Tuesday release. A lot of people have already been playing this. I know you and your family have already seen a lot of this game, right?
It's so ridiculous.
Because there's a way, if you're kind of savvy with the internet and know how to use Japanese yen, that you could have had the game for a few weeks now, because it's been released in Japan a couple weeks ago. Please explain.
Yeah, my brother didn't want to wait. He bought Microsoft points in yen or something like that, and then in Japan it's out, so he converted it, and somehow he downloaded it onto his Xbox. It's very complicated. I'm like, why don't you just wait 3 weeks? Because this game, you die like 1,000 times, a million times in this game, right?
If you go to our YouTube page on Video Game Sophistry VGS, you can see a video that was posted by Bandai where the guys from Silicon Valley, those great comedians,
great show,
play the game. They play it with one of the people from Software and are just obliterated. It's real, real funny. So check it out. It's a very niche game. It is a very, very niche game. But for those people that love it, as Tom in the break, how did you describe the fans of Dark Souls?
Yeah, people who like Dark Souls are like people who like jazz music. They're few and far between, but they care intensely.
They do indeed. They really, really love it. And a lot of people, like a lot of big reviewers and gaming critics, like adore these games more than anything. What about you guys? I'm going to the panel here.
I absolutely love Dark Souls.
Really?
I am jazz fan, if you put it in that, in that perspective.
I've only ever played Bloodborne, which is from the same maker, right, of Dark Souls. But I loved that. I'm down to give Dark Souls a try.
Dark Souls is going to take a lot of your time. So it's a big investment. We're busy, guys. We're going from that to, of course, Nason.
Ratchet and Clank coming back from the PS2. It's a remake for the PS4. That's what they're trying to envision. Little unknown fact, or I guess known fact, depending on how big of a fan you are. Ratchet and Clank has been around since 2002.
Wow.
If you pre-order the game, you get a gun called the Bouncer, which is a homing mini bomb that bounces towards any enemy that you shoot it at, which I think is kind of cool as well. I'll probably pre-ordering it.
No, that was one of the most traditionally PlayStation games, a title that was associated with PlayStation for a really, really long time. In its early development, a lot of people went crazy for it. I remember playing it as well myself. I wasn't the biggest fan, but they're making a movie with that game coming out soon. So clearly, you know, the fix is in. People want to play it. When's that coming out again?
April 12th.
Big Tuesday release. Mm-hmm. Matt, the intern, this is a game that you just love. When I said you're talking about this, you got to your phone and said...
I was absolutely thrilled.
Yeah.
No, but I do like the Fallout franchise. But Fallout 4 Wasteland Workshop. This is going to be advancing your crafting, like... beyond measures.
Yeah.
And it's going to be a DLC.
Right? Yeah.
DLC. And you're going to be able to actually catch more animals other than, you know, your loving dog meat, the German Shepherd. Maybe you can get a cat, call it Tuna Can. I don't know, something like that. But
you don't have to do that.
I mean, you could.
It's a Pokemon simulator. Yeah, it's a Pokemon simulator for Fallout. There we go. Matt the intern. Excellent. Tom the intern. Next up, marketing director, of course, of the Anime Club. At Humber College. Please continue.
Bravely Second End Lair, which is the sequel to Bravely Default, one of the biggest 3DS games in the past couple of years.
Do you know why I gave you this game?
And it's coming out on the 15th of April this week, and it is coming out for the 3DS only. It's been out for over a year in Japan now.
Do you know why I gave you this game?
Is it because I'm the marketing director at Humber's Anime Club?
Tom, everyone! Round of applause!
Good job, Tom.
Great job, Tom. Tom, the intern, make sure you pick up Bravely Second End Lair 3DS April 15th. Shaggy Davidson, finishing it up. You're the anchor, boy.
Yes, sir. Sticking with the 3DS, we got a couple games, actually three coming up for the 3DS. The Legend of Zelda, A Link to the Past. You remember that game?
Mm-hmm.
Super Metroid coming to 3DS. One of my personal favorites coming up. Donkey Kong Country 2, Diddy Kong's Quest.
We've used so many Donkey Kong ditties. Like these are the soundtrack, and this is going to be a feature that we're talking about later this episode, where we look at a lot of music in video games that really resonated with us and how it made us think about some great achievements we've had. But Donkey Kong Country, I don't know, it's one of the most memorable
easily
soundtracks for me. Maybe it's our generation, we're in that age group, but
it's the millennials.
Yeah, old people. That we, it really, really sits with us. I hear a little bit of that, like when we play it here, I want to start jumping for barrels, grabbing crystals and...
Bananas. They're not crystals.
No, but there was the one crystal. That was like the big thing.
They've been balloons.
Very exciting.
I feel like you're distracted with Crash Bandicoot, but that's just me.
Big thanks to the interns, of course. What's New Pussycat? All of the games coming out this week. We have News of the Week. Shaggy Dave.
This week in gaming...
I've got to do the news!
The new firmware update for the PlayStation 4 allows users to stream your game from your console to a Mac or a PC. The only thing is that your computer has to be super awesome and have at least Windows 8 or 10. The PS4 and the computer must be on the same network, and you have to install the Remote Play app. For further list instructions, check out our website at 640toronto.com/VGS.
Better now to watch your strip.
We can finally close the Overwatch butt pose case. Tracer's character will now do a strut victory pose called the over-the-shoulder instead of the controversial butt pose. Blizzard altered the pose after some fan decided to complain, saying that it just reduces Tracer to another bland female sex symbol. Congratulations, buddy. You won. Gears of War 4 now has a release date, October 11th, 2016. In order to get you back into the Gears mood, the beta will be released on April 18th, but only for those who played the Ultimate Edition for Xbox One and Windows 10. All other Xbox Live Gold members get their shot at the beta on April 25th. If you have a pirated version of Quantum Break, well, first of all, you're cheap. And second of all, the main character Jack will be wearing an eye patch for the entire game. On Remedy's frequently asked questions page, there's a Jack's a pirate issue. Remedy's response just tells him to reboot the game and eat a lot of vitamin C. Good for you, Remedy. So don't be cheap, and don't be a pirate, because Jerry Seinfeld says it best.
But I don't want to be a pirate!
Big thank you to Shaggy Dave once again for his killer news of the week. We got to take a quick break. When we get back on the other side, we're going to discuss a lot of that news, figure out what the panel thinks, and you can have your say. VGS Talk Radio, AM 640.
This is VGS with Andy and Dave on Talk Radio, AM 640.
I feel bad. I don't even want to speak because this is some iconic music here on VGS. So we just play it for the next, like, 35 minutes?
This is a five-minute segment.
35 minutes it is.
A minute left.
This is VGS Talk Radio AM 640. Andy Burkowski here talking about video games. Some great news of the week from Shaggy Dave just a few minutes ago.
Thank you.
Really excellent.
I know.
Really above and beyond.
You don't have to tell me. I know.
I think one of your biggest and most interesting news stories has to be the remote play of the PlayStation. Looking around the room here with the interns, they all agreed. They love the idea. Let's take us through exactly what will happen. Basically, with a new update that's coming out, you can use through a very pretty simple system. There's a bunch of articles out there. Just a couple of cords, a couple of downloaded apps, and you can play your PlayStation remotely from different locations on your PC or Mac. Fellas, you know, what do you think about this? Because my first thought was, oh, I'll use it to stream because we do a lot of videos here on VGS. Go to YouTube, type in Video Game Sophistry, and you'll see tons of the videos we do. But apparently the resolution, Matt, you're telling me, isn't quite up to par.
Well, it's about 720p, so it's average. I mean, it's still HD, but it's not 1080p. My favorite thing about it is compatibility. So a lot of people who use the PlayStation controller on a PC would have to download another driver. Mm. And the fact that Microsoft and Sony are working together, I think it's great.
Doesn't this kind of defeat the purpose of having a PlayStation or an Xbox at home, though? You know what I mean? Like, yeah, it's convenient for me to take my laptop to school or to work and enjoy these games outside of it. And I think the streaming aspect is wicked. I think it's really awesome because I do it on my PS Vita all the time. But when I'm outside, I feel like when I'm at school, I should be paying attention. I feel like this is going to distract a lot of people being a student myself.
You have to get the controller out to use it, though. So it's not as if you can do it discreetly in class, right?
No, fair enough. You're right. You're absolutely right. Yeah, that makes sense.
You need the box to even stream to begin with, no?
I feel like this is going to cost money, no? This is going to cost money?
For whom?
For us.
Well, apparently this is just a natural update at this point. So we'll see. You're right. There's a lot of questions here. But Xbox does something kind of similar with, you know, the Windows 10 thing we talked about before, UWP and everything associated with that. Tom, marketing director of the Anime Club at Humber College.
You're just not going to let that go.
No, right? You've been silent on this one. What do you...
Bloodborne is officially coming to PC, finally. I can play Bloodborne at school now if I want to.
But you can't use a computer. Like, a lot of people want that because they want to use... keyboard.
You can only ask for so much.
There you go. You know? I want to end it there. That is excellent. So we think it's a pretty good thing. Nason is a little skeptical. Damn Nason. Next up, though, another topic that we all thought was pretty important.
Are you ready, kids?
Aye, aye, Captain!
I can't hear you!
Aye, aye, Captain!
Oh!
What is it?
I'm sorry. I'm just laughing at SpongeBob and was it Mr. Krabs? Is that his name?
No, that's just the pirate.
No, it's the pirate, yeah. But no, it's the same voice actor who plays in
Sounds like Tom. It.
No, I'm talking about Quantum Break, the big release that came out this week for PC and Xbox. Remedy Games has been known to do this in the past with Alan Wake. Turns out if you download Quantum Break illegally, the main character will have an eye patch, a pirate patch, over his face.
It's pretty cool.
That is amazing.
Yeah.
I love that.
It's like F-U.
Well, one more time?
F-U.
How do you spell that?
E-F-F-U.
Perfect. Well, I think that's great, and it's kind of a shame just because, like, it'll make sense if you're making videos or streaming, but if you're playing by yourself, it won't really affect the gameplay that much. We looked on the internet. Tom, the intern, marketing director of the anime club at Humber College, took a look and compiled us with a short list of some of the punishments in the past game developers have hoisted upon people that decided to steal. This one's one of my favorites. In Batman Arkham Asylum, that's the first one, right? The first of this new that's iteration of Batman. You couldn't glide as Batman if you downloaded illegally.
Yeah, you can only get so far in the game. You have to go to the Batcave. Once you glide across that part, you're done.
And you couldn't play that. That's a basic function. And I love this quote because people were complaining about this. And one of the developers said, it's not a bug in the game's code. It's a bug in your moral code.
Damn.
So that's pretty cold.
Shot through the heart.
Shot through the heart. Just can't wait. I love this one. There's some other little niche games out there. Like Tom was saying, the Sims 4 censorship that you get when you play. You know the Sims games?
Yeah,
and
I know it.
Well, if they get naked, they're pixelated and they say they're simulating gibberish. Well, that pixelation will be for your characters always if you download it illegally. So imagine that game. It would just be these pixelated blobs.
Oh, it's not just the characters. It's the whole screen.
Oh, it's everything.
Everything, yeah.
So it's just nothing. It's just a headache
on
the screen.
Yeah, it's just a big blur.
Complete blur.
These game developers are evil.
They're smart.
They're smart
well,
and
how,
evil.
Okay, look, how much is it for Arkham Asylum now? $10?
Probably.
How cheap are you?
Well, for some people.
Seriously, can you fork out $10? You make that an hour. That's minimum wage. That's 1 hour of your work to buy Batman Arkham Asylum.
It's not worth it.
You're so damn cheap.
I didn't do it.
It's everybody else. Still, it's $10. Come on.
Well, this final one I thought was really cool. There's a game called Game Dev Tycoon. It's in like the Roller Coaster Tycoon pantheon. And if you pirate that game of Game Dev Tycoon, you play the game normally, and then at one point, your game will start to be pirated in the game, and you'll lose money, and you won't be able to do it anymore.
Good.
So that is the most appropriate hubris. For choices like this. They do be cracking down. Big thanks to the interns for joining in. They'll be with us next segment. That will be when they really shine. Make sure you check us out online, 640eternal.com/VGS. We're going to take a quick break and then open your ears. You're going to be listening to some classic games of the past.
You're listening to VGS with Andy and Dave on Talk Radio, AM 640.
You are killing me with these intros.
Why?
Not that they're bad. It's just, it is.
There's butterflies everywhere.
Shrill. Nice. This is from Super Mario World.
Yes, it is.
And you know how I knew that?
Because you did it?
Well, no, because
you beat the game?
I beat the game, and also I recognized that this was a game from my past because it's a very iconic game for me.
Is it?
This is called a segue.
I wasn't aware.
This is VGS Talk Radio AM 640, the program where we talk about games if you're just flipping through the dials and wondering what's on your AM station. Right now, we're going to look at different music, different tones, different sounds in our past that have transported us to a completely new place. For people that play video games for a very long time, it's not seeing trailers. It's not seeing screenshots or maybe even playing a bit, I think, that takes you back to how you felt when it was there. For me, it's hearing. It's hearing the tones. It's being brought back to that world. And for our interns, it's a lot of the same thing, starting, of course, with Nason.
I remember this song takes me back to when my little brother and my twin brother saved up all their pennies they could when we were 13. My little brother was 11. And they bought me this game. And it means so much to me because it sent me on a path to do like gymnastics and to do parkour and things like that. And it made me really, really happy to know that they nourished this when I was playing this game because they knew that I was that type of person, that I wanted to do these kind of athletic things. And it was really special to me. And this game, of course, was Prince of Persia, Warrior Within. And you get this song when the Dahaka is chasing you and you're trying to escape it. And this hardcore beat comes in and you love the rift and you just want to run for your life. And every time it happened, they would just scream and yell in my ear as I'm trying to run away from this big, disgusting time monster. So
that's quite a sentence.
Yeah.
But it's cool. It's amazing how you're brought back to that place. Yeah. Right? Like when you just, it's intense music, but you're still brought back to that time, eh? So many years ago. But we're going from that. We're switching from, you know, high intensity, hardcore to something a little bit different.
See, this is beautiful ambience. I love it. Now, this game is absolutely fantastic because it just, like, it just brings me back to when me and my best friend were super big into RPGs and we're traveling through on this huge journey through Cyrodiil, just adventuring and doing quests and stuff. And we were just young and we were just like letting our minds like explode with imagination with medieval times and just adventures. When you listen to something like this, like the ambience of this, it really sparks something completely different, like just right from the childhood. And of course, this game is Oblivion, The Elder Scrolls, and this was released in 2006.
10 years ago, you're playing this game, so that is exciting. That is, man, I know what you mean. You know, hearing those
it's something
songs,
you can't even explain.
Yeah, it's difficult. Well, thank you for trying. And again, we are finishing it off with the marketing director of the Anime Club at Humber College, Thomas, who very appropriately was brought back to his magical place with this.
This music brings me back to when I was in high school. After classes were over, I would walk home, go downstairs to the basement, shut off all the lights, and turn on my PlayStation 2. And this game would transport me into another world where there was a team of friends who had to solve this mystery. And from the moment I got home and turned this on to the moment later that night when my mom would flick on the basement light to tell me that dinner was ready, I was in this world. And this game is Persona 3, which also came out in 2006.
Wow. Well, thank you all, you know, very much. It's always great because I think a lot of people who are listening have experiences like that where they hear a little bit of music and they're taken right back to it. Dave and I have the same thing, but we can't get to it right now
because
we need to introduce the interview that's coming up after the break. It's a game that I think is really important. It came out this week on Steam. It is 1979 Revolution Black Friday, the game. It looks at the Iranian Revolution. Real events, and it's a choose-your-own-adventure game, kind of like the Telltale games. Yeah, I've been playing it for the last week, and kind of like what you guys were saying, it's hard to describe how these things affect you. And I think this game kind of speaks to a greater insight into a greater way of living. It's always amazing when art can take something, show you what it's like to live in a different world, and give you insight in how you can live your own life a little bit differently. These are real stories. These are real people that died. And in the credits of this game, there's a list of people that unfortunately passed away because of this revolution. Different people that contributed to this game. So it's a very important game. Some games are difficult to go through. This is a game that can be, but it's a game you have to go through because you have to see what gaming can do. You know, if anyone ever asks, are games art? I would suggest they play 1979 Revolution, the game. Black Friday coming up after the break. Our interview, Navid Khonsari, the creator of the game. He shows you the whole thing. He tells you what it's like, and he explains why this is a special game. Coming up after this, Andy Burkowski, VGS, Talk Radio, AM 640. Jumping into a video game can so effectively take us to different worlds, but we use the medium to tell stories of our past. In some cases, the people who even lost their lives to bring us these stories, it becomes a very special experience. I've had one of those really special experiences this week. I've been playing 1979 Revolution Black Friday. You can finish it up in a day or so.
It's one of those special games, and we thought here on VGS it's important to speak with one of the lead minds behind it. Navid Khonsari is here. It's a game that examines the Iranian Revolution, some heavy stuff. Thank you, Navid, for joining the program.
Thanks for having me.
Well, first of all, how does it feel? Because I know this has been a process of developing this game. There's been a lot of people helping out. I went through the credits list. A lot of people wanted to be a part of this game. It came out this week. How does it feel?
It feels great. You know, this this project, from its inception to its release a few days ago, has definitely been a struggle to a certain degree. But the end result and the reward has been incredible. I just, from what we're seeing of people's responses, the love and the emotion that's coming through, and the gratitude for creating this project, from people not who just experienced it or are Iranian, but from groups across the West, Southeast Asia. It's just been a phenomenal response, and I think it really makes it worthwhile. You know, the idea of making a video game about the 1979 revolution, on one side, doesn't necessarily pop out being a huge commercial hit, and on the other side, can come across as being insensitive. And I think we were able to navigate that road to say that we can create these real stories and make them engaging. We can make them entertaining. And in the process, we can be sensitive because the process that we approach is more like a documentary. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to tell the stories of real people rather than trying to glorify one element of the event.
Do you personally have any link or connection to those events in 1979?
Absolutely. You know, I grew up in Iran until I was 10 years old and left after the revolution, actually left after the hostage crisis. And my grandfather took me by my hand and took me out onto the streets during the summer of 1978 to actually see what was taking place. And even though I was 10 years old, I was taken back by the spirit of hope and the possibility of change that existed amongst all the civilians that were out on the street. You can't deny that. It just hasn't. It just kind of takes over you. Mm-hmm. And then 6 or 7 months later, I'm in my apartment with my mom and my dad and my brothers, and the soldiers start shooting. And even though it's maybe down the block, the fear in my mother's voice to ask me to kind of get lower, so I'm lower than the window level, really kind of showed me the spectrum of the revolution and the change that it had taken, and how what was being fought for was slowly kind of changing into something else. And that's really, that experience is what I wanted to kind of capture. And especially today with the political rhetoric that's going on, especially in the U.S., especially coming from guys like Donald Trump, and then on the other end of the spectrum with what you've got with ISIS, I think it's absolutely important to provide a narrative that shows people from that part of the world in a positive way, but also can show people who only know Iran from 35 years of news reports of clerics and women in chadors and terrorism, to actually understand that this is a group of people that are not reflected by that 2-minute news clip that you see.
Well, as a Westerner who's looking into this, who is aware of the events of the Iranian Revolution, it was more than a culture shock. It was almost a revelation to see how, I think, effectively you were able to capture a sense of day-to-day life, a sense of a civilization that is old and respects traditions, and how that can be used to make their world and just day-to-day activities that much grander. Like the sense of civility that you see in every instance of this game, just the little insight you get into that Iran of, you know, 35 years ago, was incredible. What has been some of the response like this from Westerners looking in? And how was that process for you? Because I imagine it's a tightrope to walk. You don't want to get too intense with the very, you know, heavy subject matter, but you also want to make sure it's accurate. So, yeah, where was that line for you?
Well, I mean, in the end, we kind of look to ourselves and what kind of experience would we want to kind of enjoy. And having come from a background of directing games like Grand Theft Auto and Max Payne, I understood the importance of engagement through great narrative stories that were also, that were entertaining. But at the same time, we were covering an era, a momentous occasion, as far as I'm concerned, in the 20th century, that created the first Islamic Republic. And the implications are still being felt today as the relationship between the West and Iran still stays contentious as it starts to kind of get a little, hopefully become a little bit more diplomatic. So for us, it was really important to make sure that we engage everyone regardless of their cultural background, that they could understand that. And I think everyone, regardless of where you're from, regardless of whether you live in a city or you live in a small town, you've had that belief that you could change something, that you could change, whether it's your community, whether it's the world, and you've taken to the streets. And that's universal. And then how that kind of plays out is also universal, because it's never really what you kind of fought for. It becomes an adaptation of that. So it was really a combination of making sure that we engage and entertain people, but at the same time, we stay truthful to the events, but not make it so political, not make it so about just what was taking place, that we lose the most important element of this, which is these are actually happening to real people, and these people don't walk down the streets, all they think about is Khomeini or the Shah. They also have the cultural elements that are in the game, like the cultural grace of Tarof, you know, or other, where you go endlessly to endless means to show your grace towards guests that come over, learning about Persian bread, learning about Persian food as well, combined with the fact that you'll come across graffiti that was done by the Mujahideen and death to the Shah. So it was really bringing in that culture as well as the politics, because I believe that the greatest language that we have internationally is pop culture. You could grab people from different corners of the world, and if they've played the same game, they can have a conversation about that game regardless of their language. We've seen, you know, this happened to me when I first came to Canada. Mm-hmm. Was I was able to make friends by my conversations about movies like Star Wars or video games that I was playing at the time. And for me, I think that that's a really, really important lesson, and something that we wanted to make sure we get in this, is to make this for everybody, not just a specific group.
Absolutely. In terms of making it a game, you've chosen to allow players to experience this world in a very specific way. It's very much similar to the Choose Your Own Adventure type of style of gameplay, with great narrative scenes, sequences, chapter to chapter, and a lot of choices. When you were looking at this as a project and you decided that this would be the way you tell this story, why did this approach seem like the most effective in terms of gameplay?
Well, in terms of gameplay, you know, we looked at a number of different kind of designs that have been used, and they just didn't fit. What we wanted to do was create morality. We wanted you to have choices that were based on real life. I think most games are based on the colors black and white. And by that, I mean you have a mission, you have to overcome that mission, and then you go to the next level. And usually when it comes to overcoming those missions, you have an obstacle. In traditional games that deal with the Middle East, it's about not killing a whole bunch of people so you can get to that next level, to that next bunker. In our situation, when you're doing a story based on real life and somebody starts shooting, you don't pick up a gun and start charging them. You try to find safety, and in doing so, you have to make a choice of who you're going to actually help out of your family members that are on either side of you. I believe that there's great suspense in that, and I believe that making choices can actually enhance that suspense. And so we wanted to break away from the tradition action-driven suspense and get a little bit more meta. We wanted to get a little bit more into people's heads and have their choices, their morality, determine the path that they're going to take. And it also allowed us to not just make cerebral choices, but physical choices. Are you going to be passive, or are you going to be aggressive when it comes to somebody giving you a rock and asking you to throw it at the soldiers? And how does that interpret in terms of who those soldiers are to you? Because pretty soon you're going to find out that you actually have members in your family that are also soldiers.
Mm-hmm. Speaking again with Navid Khonsari, creator of the game 1979 Revolution, Black Friday, speaking of this Choose Your Own Adventure game and why this sort of gameplay was the best choice to tell this story. It's interesting because a lot of games like this, they give you these choices. You know, there's Game of Thrones games that are like that, where you make different choices for different characters. And it always seems a little impotent of a choice. You don't know these characters, they're not connected, and it doesn't have that meta sense. What I loved about playing Revolution was the idea that if I made a passive or aggressive choice, I was reflecting a real person who had to make a similar sort of choice. It's a very rare phenomenon of experience in almost any kind of media that when I was making choices, I became literal people. Looking at history, you looked at this as, like you said, almost like a director making a documentary. Were you able to see people, regular people, that had to make choices like that because of the realities of what was going on in Iran at that time period?
Absolutely. I mean, I think if anything, the revolution forced people to make choices. You know, the options weren't there. What do you do? What do you do when the entire infrastructure of society kind of gets turned upside down and is being rebuilt from the ground up under a new set of ideals that you had no idea about a week ago? And so I saw people who were unbelievably generous, unbelievably kind, turn the other cheek and look the other way because of their own fear. And I don't feel that they were wrong or that they should be blamed. I can appreciate that. I'm empathetic towards that situation. And I also saw people who were considered to be not necessarily nice, or taking advantage of power as the regime started changing, show once in a while elements of kindness and generosity. And so I think we really wanted to kind of capture that because that's what I saw. I saw greatness, and I saw ugliness in people because of a situation which wasn't necessarily an extension of who they were. And I feel like that is a great reflection of human nature during these times of upheaval, and really want to kind of make sure we capture that and allow people to experience that so that they can actually have an understanding. And no other medium, whether it's films, whether it's documentaries, puts you actually in the shoes of those who can experience it. And that in itself is something that can lead much quicker and have a deeper impact in terms of understanding one another.
I would say so. Again, it's a game you can get through relatively quickly. It's maybe a day or so. But as soon as I was done, I immediately wanted to play again. And I think one of the biggest reasons why was the moments, for me at least, playing it. And there's a slight spoiler for those that haven't played it, but you eventually get to see your family home. You get to visit your parents of this character in the game. And when you take that opportunity, you see little windows into real people's lives. You sourced, you know, home movies, photos, letters. That process, first of all, where did you get that material? And what was that process like finding the real stories of people that went through this during that time period?
Well, a lot of that material, and particularly the home movies, are movies that my grandfather shot on Super 8.
Really?
From the 1950s, yeah, until 1979. In fact, the first day of school, that's me on my first day of school. The young woman swimming at the Caspian Sea, that's actually my mom. And so this project was... is so important and has been challenging because nobody's ever done something like this, that I felt that one of the ways to ensure success is to not talk about it on a very macro level, but to put myself into it, to put my own experiences as well as the people that we interviewed. So much of the other stories that give you an insight on the mother and the father, their relationship, the older brother, that came from all the interviews that we did, the themes that kind of rose to the top, and that allowed us to also make a game, tell a story that wasn't just about the main character, but actually covered a spectrum of people with different backgrounds and also age. Mm-hmm. You know, people tend to, all these main characters in games traditionally are like young, huge muscle guys that can kind of go crashing through walls. But what's more important for me anyways is the dynamics between a mother and son, the son and his father, his son and his best friend, but who are from different classes. All of these elements, I think, just kind of enrich the fabric of the narrative that you get to experience.
Without question, there was one moment also in the credits that I think is unique to a video game that I've maybe never seen
in a game or other pieces of media, there's a moment where you had to thank the names of people who had to remain nameless due to anonymity. I'd love to, you know, what was the reason for that? And why did you guys make that choice? Because it really, considering the subject matter, it really, really stood out to me that, you know, people experience this and they're still feeling the effects.
Absolutely. I mean, look, in the opening credits, a number of the artists that have helped work on this project went under pseudonyms in order to not reveal who they are. Not because they're even concerned about repercussions to them, but because they still have family in Iran. Mm-hmm. A number of people that we did interviews with didn't even have family in Iran, but this this belief still exists amongst many of the people that offered their help, their services to us, was that they want to be able to go back, and they know that the present government, especially the way that they've gone after journalists, as well as the way that they see people who are not, or who are thumbing their nose at the government, or are basically working outside of the parameters of what the Islamic laws are, could get in trouble, and more importantly, can be randomly picked up for an affiliation by having a credit in the game. So, out of concern for them, out of their own concerns, I would say we probably have about 30% of the people who are not credited. Because of their concerns for family as well as concerns for themselves. And it's unfortunate, but I fully respect it, especially seeing that, you know, a few years ago when the idea for this game came out, a website in Iran affiliated to one of the news outlets deemed me as making American propaganda and being a spy. So you can appreciate that when people start getting involved, and that's one of the things that that's being attached to me, they're very much concerned. Saying that, I do believe that what we have created and what we have portrayed is very, very accurate, is extremely honest, and doesn't take any kind of specific political sides. So I'm interested to see how the Iranian government is going to take to this content.
Again, speaking with Navid Khonsari, creator, 1979 Revolution, Black Friday. I've been playing it all this week. It's a game that is one of a kind, looking at the Iranian Revolution. Of all the themes that you explore in this title, you, like you said there, the relationship between mother and father, the relationship between different people of different classes, and almost the idea of protecting values versus their quest for freedom, the reality that so many of these young people faced in Iran at that time period. For you as a creator of art, what was the most compelling of all these great themes that you thought should almost play center stage when you were creating this game?
I think for me, this entire journey has been extremely, extremely emotional. But not emotional because of the content that I've been able to kind of add or put into it, but because of the love that we were able to kind of create between the characters, mm-hmm. the dynamics between everybody involved, and yet this nucleus of love is kind of getting stretched in so many different ways because of the political fractions that existed and the difference between how people think because of the generational differences. All of those elements kind of pulled at it, and it felt so natural. You know, every actor that we had in this project is Iranian-American, Iranian-German, and every one of them was able to bring something to the table beyond just being a phenomenal actor. They had stake in the game because they were affected by it. Whether they're the generation of Iranians that have come to the West, or whether they are the first or half generation that's come to the West, the emotions that were being poured out onto the motion capture floor, the emotion that came out in the voiceover performance, the emotion of everybody being involved, the level of love and care, I think just kind of transpired and is in this game. And that's what makes the moral choices and this journey interesting one, and one that's also suspenseful, because you can kind of feel that in the creation. And that's why I was saying it was such an emotional experience for me, because we were able to put that in, and it didn't come from me. It came from everybody involved. because everybody could kind of relate to the experience, whether they were Iranian or not, I should add as well.
Well, yeah, I think it's a very human experience for someone who, you know, grew up in a Western society and just was looking into these incidents. I reloaded the game near the end because something horrible happened to someone who you developed such a great relationship. And I reloaded that 5 or 6 times to try to get a different outcome. But I think the game was really effective at making you feel like the stakes were real. In terms of the ability to look back, because you know what's happened historically and to present date because of this revolution, what was your, I guess, responsibility to leave certain pieces of information in to kind of tell the foreboding nature of what might happen and subsequently did happen if the Ayatollah did succeed in what he was looking for? Because I noticed it a bit in a lot of the speeches that you chose from Khomeini to leave in the game, and a lot of the propaganda you chose to leave. I love, you know, the sense of history that even made it more intense. It must have been a difficult process.
It was a difficult process, but I think what's really important is that if you're creating an experience, you have to recognize that you have to provide the audience, in whether they're playing games, or you have to give them the ability, the options to discover things on their own. And if I start trying to tell people that this is the right way or that's the wrong way, it's not going to work. But what we do have, which is a very kind of a luxurious position to be in, is that we're talking about an event that took 36 years ago. Mm-hmm. And people can now take a look at it and make an assessment based on this game of how things have changed. The comments that Khomeini makes, for example, about never wanting to be a part of the government and only wanting to be a spiritual advisor, I don't have to do anything other than put that in there for you to be able to engage with. You can come to your own conclusion, and I actually feel like those are the jewels of discovery that really make the experience worthwhile. If I told you, well, this is what he did, and now look at what he's done, I'm just preaching. But if you can come to that discovery on your own, then I think it's much more powerful. And in fact, I think that's what starts the conversation when you start talking about the game or when you start talking about the historical moment, regardless of the game.
A game like this, do you think that it would be a more palatable experience for people that don't play games as often, people that aren't traditionally gamers, to get insight into this incident that happened in Iran? Do you think you've created in a way where it's open enough that people who don't play can jump right in?
Absolutely. I mean, initially, the game's coming out right now on Steam, so it's for PCs and Mac, but our goal is to actually bring it to within the next 6 weeks to smartphones so that it can be experienced more worldwide. And we want it to be respectful of those who play games to make sure that we bring the challenge and we bring the morality of the narrative to it. But how you are going to engage with it should be able to be played by my nephew, Reza, who's 10 years old, all the way to his grandfather. And that's the goal, is making sure that we actually introduce people who think gaming is a bunch of guys sitting in a dark room behind a monitor, to saying that everyone is actually a gamer. This is not a new medium. This is an engaging medium that takes very little for you to kind of get involved with. As far as I'm concerned, if you have a phone and you punch in a security code, you now officially become a gamer, because that's the challenge. If you put in the right code, you pass and you move on. So our goal is to really make an experience that's accessible to everyone.
Big thanks again to Navid Khonsari, creator of 1979 Revolution Black Friday. Personally, it's a game that really resonated with me, and it's rare to be playing an experience and thinking that you're doing something that's important, experiencing a piece of media that, you know, you hope at least that people look back on years from now and recognize its value. What do you hope, I guess? The game's out. You've done all this work. What do you hope this leads to in terms of a response from the community?
I hope that it's embraced by the community. I hope it's embraced by audiences so that we can kind of continue on with our work. I feel like we've just kind of scratched the surface of what we've done. We've learned a lot, and I think we can apply it to future iterations. And I really hope that actually we also motivate designers and creatives and technologists to see this as an opportunity to try to maybe tell the stories, the historical stories that are important to them. And we are excited to share the template of how we've gone about this, as well as the engine that we've created. Because we're not looking at making a game. Our goal is at establishing a genre in gaming, which we're referring to as Verite Games. So we're excited about this being out there. We are humbled by how it's being embraced by people. We hope that we can continue on this path so that we can, quite simply, as a small indie development team, make enough money so that we could do the next iteration, which will be, you know, working on the improvements and what we've learned from feedback from the audience. And then the next step is to be able to share this so that we can do everything from stories about, let's say, the American cultural revolution of the 1960s, with the Black Panthers, with the Vietnam War, with LSD, with the rise of feminism, all the way to, let's say, Louis Riel up in Canada, in terms of how that rebellion kind of played out, all the way to the death march, the death groups in El Salvador, and how that became the M13 gangs in L.A., to the rest of the world. So I think that we really are excited about what we've created here, about the genre that we're establishing, and hopefully with the right support, we can continue doing this and sharing this so that this becomes a recognized, not just medium, but a recognized way of people being able to engage with history, and hopefully actually through that starting conversations and understanding.
Big thanks again. This game is incredible. Make sure you pick it up. 1979 Revolution Black Friday, available now on Steam. This is VGS. I'm Andy Burkowski on Talk Radio AM 640. We'll be back right after the break. And Navid, this is a little extra that I'm going to do on the website right now. I just wanted to talk about, do you have just a couple more minutes? You good?
Sure.
Yeah. So in terms of how, because I've played through it a few times, it's a game that leaves you at the very end feeling not a way that a lot of games do. It doesn't put a nice little bow on the story. Everything's not, you know, it doesn't complete the full circle, I think. And it made me feel the real sense of loss. What was your choice in terms of how you wanted to end the game to leave it? Because I had the ending where I saved my brother, but I was still defiant at the end. You don't really get a resolution from that. Why did you guys make that choice as development team?
The main reason for that was simple, in terms of that scene that you're talking about is really an outcome of an earlier choice that you kind of made. And it's actually not about you, which was what we wanted to make it about, the impact you had on others, and in this particular, your brother. Mm-hmm. And I think it was about his reactions to what you did. This goes back to the larger conversation we were having about big choices and little choices. That was a big choice, but that choice that you make in 1978 actually has created this sense of resentment that goes all the way to 1980. Mm-hmm. And through interrogations and through Evin prison for both you and your brother. And so that's why we wanted to kind of leave it like that. And quite simply, we would really love to have people talking about this, and putting a feel-good ending just wasn't accurate, quite simply. It wasn't honest. It wasn't accurate. And we wanted to do something that was exactly that, truthful, and kind of based on real life and real events. And unfortunately, you just can't tie it up and put it in the corner in a nice little bow. So that's what we kind of did that. And our goal, hopefully, is that the characters that we've created, the story that we've created, can certainly go on to have a sequel. And hopefully that's where we'll take it if we can actually, you know, if we hit, and I hope we do, the numbers that we need in order to jump onto the next iteration or another historical story.
If I had made dramatically different choices in that game, two important questions just for me. Would, the friend that I supported throughout everything, would he still, unfortunately, lose his life, and would I have a different ending?
This isn't recording, right?
What's that?
This isn't recording.
No, this is us chatting. This is us chatting.
Okay, yeah, that's a big spoiler.
Yeah.
No. He is the fatal repercussion. Mm-hmm. Because he is the heart of the story. And the revolution after Black Friday lost its heart in terms of as a movement. Mm-hmm. And so that's who he kind of exemplifies. And that's why the choices that go on from there really are about whether you give in to anger and hate and violence, or you give towards being passive and trying to do a nonviolent protest, which is obviously not the direction that the revolution went after that. So he represented the death of innocence, and I didn't want to in any way walk away from that. I wanted to focus on the two two more extreme, like the Che Guevara revolutionary and my brother, who is the hardcore soldier, because that also has the ability to kind of work much better with history in the aftermath of Black Friday.
This is VGS with Andy and Dave on Talk Radio, AM 640.
Big thank you for everyone sticking around, listening to our show on VGS, Talk Radio, AM 640. A big thank you, of course, to Navid Khonsari. He was the voice you just heard before the break talking about 1979 Revolution Black Friday. A very important game, a very special game in the pantheon of games. Check it out on Steam. It's only $10.
Very well spoken, too.
It's honestly, we only got, unfortunately, a little taste, right?
Just a taste, yeah. Brother.
If you want to hear the entire thing, it's almost 45 minutes long, head to our website, 640toronto.com/VGS. We have some articles, that's the word I'm looking for, yep, from the interns up there. Big thanks, you guys, for joining the program. How was it today?
I loved it.
Yeah, today was a great day. Absolutely.
Fantastic. Thanks for having me.
And for the marketing director of the Anime Club of Humber College, what did you think?
I think it was the second best thing I could have done, aside from watching anime.
There you go. Great to have him on.
Great answer.
Great to have you guys on. And thank you all for sharing those personal experiences about games that were really important to you. If you're listening right now and just thinking, you know what? I have thoughts about games. I want to get out there. Send us an email, right, Dave?
Yeah. Do it.
What's the email?
VGS at 640.
They don't know.
VGS at 640toronto.com.
And of course, if you want to continue to speak with us, at VGS underscore 640 Twitter.
On Twitters. We also have our personal ones. We're all there.
Yeah,
Facebook, Video Game Sophistry, YouTube, yeah. Video Game Sophistry. I don't know. What's the word with the Instagram?
I don't know. One of the interns is doing. Not one here, but we don't have to worry about that. This is a gaming show, damn it.
Yeah, we take photos of games.
Big thank you to everyone for listening up. But make sure you head to the website, because as much as we can talk about here, there's a lot more there. And thank you, Shaggy Dave.
Yes. Again, we only have an hour, so everything is up on the website if you miss anything. If you're just catching the tail end of this,
yeah,
you missed the full hour, so you suck. So just get the podcast
That's
version.
Not nice. All right. Thanks again, Andy Burkowski.
Shaggy Dave.
And this is VGS.
Without a doubt, the worst episode ever. Rest assured that I was on the internet within minutes, registering my disgust throughout the world.